Fourth marking period. Exterminators. The PTA has started a petition to get rid of the hornet as our school mascot. It was the cheer that got to them. They heard it at the last basketball game. We are the hornets, horny, horny hornets. Everywhere we go, oh, people want to know, oh, who we are, so we tell them. We are the hornets, horny, horny hornets. And on and on and on. The wiggles and shakes that accompany the cheer freaked out the Merriweather PTA. Freaked out PTAs all over the city when the horny hornet cheer was televised. The TV sports guy thought the song was cute, so he did a segment showing the hornet hustle with the cheerleaders shaking their stingers and the crowd bumping and grinding the horny hornet hinies. The student council started a counter petition. The Honor Society wrote it. It describes the psychological harm we have all suffered from this year's lack of identity. It pleads for consistency, stability. It's pretty good. We, the students of Merriweather High, have become proud of our hornet selves. We are tenacious, stinging, clever. We are a hive, a community of students. Don't take away our hornetdom. We are hornets. It won't be a real issue until football starts up again. Our baseball team always stinks. The wet season. Spring is on the way. The winter rats, rusty brown $700 cars that everyone with sense drives from November until April, are rolling back into storage. The snow is melting for good and the pretty baby shiny cars glitter in the senior parking lot. There are other signs of spring. Front lawns cough up the shovels and mittens that were gobbled by snowdrifts in January. My mother moved the winter coats up to the attic. Dad's been mumbling about the storm windows, but hasn't taken them down. From the bus, I saw a farmer walking his field, waiting for the mud to tell him when to plant. April Fool's Day is when most seniors get their acceptance or rejection letters from college. Thumbs up or thumbs down. It's a sick piece of timing. Tensions are running high. Kids drink pink stomach medicine from the bottle. David Petrakis, my lab partner, is writing a database program to track who got in where. He wants to analyze which advanced placement classes the seniors took, their standardized test scores, extracurricular, and GPAs to figure out what he needs to do to get into Harvard. I've been going to most of my classes. Good girl, Melly. Roll over, Melly. Sit, Melly. No one has patted me on the head, though. I passed an algebra test. I passed an English test. I passed a biology test. Well, hallelujah. It is all so profoundly stupid. Maybe this is why kids join clubs, to give them something to think about during class. Andy Beast joined the International Club. I hadn't figured him for a deep interest in Greek cooking or French museums. He has abandoned the Martha table and hangs around and onto Rachel / Rochelle and Greta Ingrid and all the other resident aliens. Rochelle flutters her purple eyelashes at him like he's some kind of Uber dude. You'd think she'd have more sense. Easter came and went without much notice. I think it caught my mother by surprise. She doesn't like Easter because the date keeps shifting and it's not a big shopping holiday. When I was a kid, Mom used to hide colored eggs for me all over the house. The last egg was inside a big basket of chocolate rabbits and yellow marshmallow chicks. Before my grandparents died, they would take me to church and I would wear stiff dresses with itchy lace. This year we celebrated by eating lamb chops. I made hard-boiled eggs for lunch and drew little faces on them with a black pen. Dad complained about how much yard work has to be done. Mom didn't say much. I said less. In heaven, my grandparents frowned. I sort of wished we had gone to church. Some of the Easter songs are pretty. Spring break. It is the last day of spring break. My house is shrinking, and I feel like Alice in Wonderland. Afraid that my head might burst through the roof, I head for the mall. I have $10 in my pocket. What to spend it on? French fries? $10 worth of French fries? Ultimate fantasy. If Alice in Wonderland were written today, I bet she'd have a supersized order of fries that said, "Eat me," instead of a small cake. On the other hand, we're rushing towards summer, which means shorts and t-shirts and maybe even a bathing suit now and then. I walk past the deep fat fryers. Now that spring is past, the fall fashions are in the store windows. I keep waiting for the year when the fashions catch up to the seasons. A couple of stores have performance artists hanging at the front door. One guy keeps flying a stupid loop-the-loop airplane. A plastic-faced woman keeps tying and retying a shawl. No, now it's a skirt. Now it's a halter top. Now it's a headscarf. People avoid looking at her as if they aren't sure if they should applaud or tip her. I feel bad for her. I wonder what her grades were in high school. I want to give her a tip, only it would be rude to ask if she has changed for a 10. I ride the escalator down to the central fountain, where today's entertainment is face painting. The line is long and loud. 6-year-olds and their mothers. A little girl walks past me. She's a tiger. She's crying about ice cream and she wipes her tears. Her tiger paint smears and her mom yells at her. What a zoo. I turn. Ivy is sitting on the edge of the fountain, a giant sketchbook balanced on her knees. She nods toward the line of whiners and the face painters furiously coloring stripes, spots, and whiskers. I feel bad for them, I say. What are you drawing? Ivy moves so I can sit next to her and hands me the sketchbook. She's drawing the kids' faces. Half of each face is plain and sad. The other half is plastered with thick clown makeup that is fake happy. She hasn't painted any tigers or leopards. The last time I was here, they were doing clown faces. No such luck today, Ivy explains. Looks good, though, I say. It's kind of spooky, not creepy, but unexpected. I hand back the sketchbook. Ivy pokes her pencil into her bun. Good, that's what I'm trying for. That turkey bone thing you did was creepy, too. Creepy in a good way, good creepy. It's been months and I'm still thinking about it. What am I supposed to say now? I bite my lip, then release it. I pull a roll of lifesavers from my pocket. One apiece? She takes one, I take three, and we suck in silence for a moment. How's the tree coming? She asks. I groan. Stinks. It was a mistake to sign up for art. I just couldn't see myself taking woodshop. You're better than you think you are, Ivy says. She opens to an empty page in the sketchbook. I don't know why you keep using a linoleum block. If I were you, I'd just let it out. Draw. Here, try a tree. We sit there trading pencils. I draw a trunk. Ivy adds a branch. I extend the branch, but it is too long and spindly. I start to erase it, but Ivy stops me. It's fine the way it is. It just needs some leaves. Layer the leaves and make them slightly different sizes, and it will look great. You have a great start there. She's right. Genetics. The last unit of the year in biology is genetics. It's impossible to listen to Miss Keene. Her voice sounds like a cold engine that won't turn over. The lecture starts with some priest named Greg who studied vegetables and ends up with an argument about blue eyes. I think I missed something. How did we leap from veggies to eye color? I'll copy David's notes. I flip ahead in the textbook. There's an interesting chapter about acid rain. Nothing about sex. We aren't scheduled to learn about that until 11th grade. David draws a chart in his notebook. I snap my pencil point and walk to the front of the room to sharpen it. I figure the walk will do me good. Miss Keene sputters on. We get half our genes from our mother and half from our father. I thought my genes came from efforts. Ha ha, biology joke. Mom says I take after Dad's side of the family. They're mostly cops and insurance salesmen who bet on football games and smoke disgusting cigars. Dad says I take off after Mom's side of the family. They're farmers who grow rocks and poison ivy. They don't say much, visit dentists, or read. When I was a little kid, I used to pretend I was a princess who had been adopted when my kingdom was overrun by bad guys. Any day, my real parents, Mr. King and Mrs. Queen, would send the royal limo to pick me up. I just about had a 7-year-old heart attack when my dad took a limo to the airport the first time. I thought they had really come to take me away, and I didn't want to go. Dad took taxis after that. I look out the window, no limos, no chariots or carriages. Now, when I really want to leave, no one will give me a ride. I sketch a willow tree drooping into the water. I won't show it to Mr. Freeman. This one is for my closet. I've been taping some of my drawings on the walls. Any more classes as boring as this one, and I'll be ready to move back in there full time. My leaves are good, natural. The trick is to make them different sizes and then crowd them one on top of another. Ivy was right. Miss Keene writes dominant recessive on the board. I look at David's notes. He's drawing a family tree. David got his hair gene from his dad and his eye gene from his mom. I draw a family tree, a family stump. There aren't that many of us. I can barely remember their names. Uncle Jim, Uncle Thomas, Aunt Mary, Aunt Kathy. There's another aunt. She's very recessive. She recessed herself all the way to Peru. I think I have her eyes. I got my I don't want to know about it gene from my dad and my I'll think about it tomorrow gene from my mom. Miss Keene says we'll have a quiz the next day. I wish I had paid attention during class. I wish I were adopted. I wish David would quit sighing when I asked to copy his notes. 10 more lies they tell you in high school. 1. You will use algebra in your adult lives. 2. Driving to school is a privilege that can be taken away. 3. Students must stay on campus for lunch. 4. The new textbooks will arrive any day now. 5. Colleges care about more than your SAT scores. 6. We are enforcing the dress code. 7. We will figure out how to turn off the heat soon. 8. Our bus drivers are highly trained professionals. 9. There's nothing wrong with summer school. 10. We want to hear what you have to say. My life as a spy. Rachel Rochelle has lost her mind. She has flipped. She went to the movies with Andy Beast and her exchange friends, and now she follows after him, panting like a Bichon Frise. Andy wears her buddy Greta Ingrid draped around his neck like a white scarf. When he spits, I bet Rachel Rochelle catches it in a cup and saves it. Rachel Rochelle and some other twit natter about the movie date before Mr. Stedman starts class. I want to puke. Rachel Rochelle is just Andy this and Andy that. Could she be more obvious? I close my ears to her stupid asthmatic laugh and work on the homework that was due yesterday. It is usually easy to do homework in class because Mr. Stedman's voice creates a gentle white noise sound barrier. I can't do it today. I can't escape the arguments circling my head. Why worry about Rachel Rochelle? He'll hurt her. Had she done a single decent thing for me the whole year? She was my best friend through middle school. That counts for something. No, she's a witch and a traitor. She didn't see what happened. Let her lust after the beast. I hope he breaks her heart. What if he breaks something else? When class is over, I slide into the middle of the pack, pushing out the door before Mr. Stedman can bust me for the homework. Rachel Rochelle shoves past me to where Greta Ingrid and a short kid from Belgium are waiting. I tail them, always keeping two bodies between us, like the detectives on television. They're on their way to the foreign language wing. That's no surprise. The foreign kids are always there, like they need to breathe air scented with their native language a couple times a day, or they'll choke to death on too much American. Andy Beast swoops over their heads, folds his wings, and sets himself between the girls as they start up the stairs. He tries to kiss Greta Ingrid's cheek, but she turns away. He kisses Rachel Rochelle's cheek, and she giggles. He does not kiss the cheek of the short Belgian. The Belgian and the Swede wave ciao at the office of the foreign language department. Rumor has it there is an espresso maker in there. The friendly momentum keeps Rachel Rochelle and Andy walking all the way to the end of the hall. I face a corner and pretend to study algebra. I figure that's enough to make me unrecognizable. They sit on the floor, Rachel Rochelle in a full lotus. Andy steals Rachel Rochelle's notebook. She whines like a baby and throws herself across his lap to get it back. I shiver with goosebumps. He tosses the notebook from one hand to the other, always keeping it just out of her reach. Then he says something to her. I can't hear it. The hall sounds like a packed football stadium. His lips move poison, and she smiles, and then she kisses him wet, not a Girl Scout kiss. He gives her the notebook. His lips move. Lava spills out my ears. She is not any part of a pretend Rochelle chick. I can only see third grade Rachel, who liked barbecue potato chips and who braided pink embroidery thread into my hair that I wore for months until my mom made me cut it out. I rest my forehead against a prickly stucco. Thin atmosphere. The best place to figure this out is my closet, my throne room, my foster home. I want a shower. Maybe I should tell Greta Ingrid. My Swedish isn't good enough. I could talk to Rachel. Yeah, right. I could say I'd heard bad things about Andy. It would only make him more attractive. I could maybe tell her what happened. As if she'd listen. What if she told Andy? What would he do? There isn't much room for pacing. I take two steps, turn, two steps back. I bang my shin against a chair. Stupid room. What a dumb idea sitting in a closet like this. I flop in the chair. It whooshes out old janitor smells. Feet, beef jerky, shirts left in the washer too long. The turkey bone sculpture gives off a faint, rotting odor. Three baby food jars of potpourri don't make a dent in the stink. Maybe there's a dead rat decomposing in the wall, right near the hot air vent. Maya Angelou watches me, two fingers on the side of her face. It is an intelligent pose. Maya wants me to tell Rachel. I take off my sweatshirt. My t-shirt sticks to me. They still have the heat running full blast, even though it's warm enough to crack open the windows. That's what I need, a window. As much as I complain about winter, cold air is easier to breathe, slipping like silver mercury down my lungs and out again. April is humid, with slush evaporating or rain drizzling. A warm, moldy washcloth of a month. The edges of my pictures curl in the damp. There has been some progress in this whole tree project, I guess. Like Picasso, I've gone through different phases. There's the confused period, when I wasn't sure what the assignment really was. The spaz period, when I couldn't draw a tree to save my life. The dead period, when all my trees looked like they had been through a forest fire or a blight. I'm getting better. Don't know what to call this phase yet. All these drawings make the closet even smaller. Maybe I should bribe a janitor to haul all this stuff to my house, make my bedroom more like this, more like home. Maya taps me on the shoulder. I'm not listening. I know. I don't want to hear it. I need to do something about Rachel, something for her. Maya tells me without saying anything. I stall. Rachel will hate me. She already hates me. She won't listen. I have to try. I groan and rip out a piece of notebook paper. I write her a note, a left-handed note, so she won't know it's from me. Andy Evans will use you. He is not what he pretends to be. I heard he attacked a ninth grader. Be very, very careful. A friend. RS, tell Greta Ingrid too. I didn't want the Swedish supermodel on my conscience either. Growing pains. Mr. Freeman is a jerk. Instead of leaving me alone to find my muse, a real quote, I swear, he lands on the stool next to me and starts criticizing. What is wrong with my tree? He overflows with words describing how bad it sucks. It's stiff, unnatural, it doesn't flow, it is an insult to trees everywhere. I agree. My tree is hopeless. It isn't art. It's an excuse not to take sewing class. I don't belong in Mr. Freeman's room anymore than I belong in the Martha's or in my little girl's pink bedroom. This is where the real artists belong. Like Ivy. I carry the linoleum block to the garbage can and throw it in hard enough to make everyone look at me. Ivy frowns through her wire sculpture. I sit back down and lay my head on the table. Mr. Freeman retrieves the block from the garbage. He brings back the Kleenex box too. How could he tell I was crying? Mr. Freeman, you are getting better at this, but it's not good enough. This looks like a tree, but it is an average, ordinary, everyday boring tree. Breathe life into it. Make it bend. Trees are flexible so they don't snap. Scar it. Give it a twisted branch. Perfect trees don't exist. Nothing is perfect. Flaws are interesting. Be the tree. He has this ice cream voice like a kindergarten teacher. If he thinks I can do it, then I'll try one more time. My fingers tip over to the linoleum knife. Mr. Freeman pats my shoulder once, then turns to make someone else miserable. I wait until he isn't watching, then try to carve life into my flat linoleum square. Maybe I could carve off all the linoleum and call it empty block. If a famous person did that, it would probably be really popular and sell for a fortune. If I do it, I'll flunk. Be the tree. What kind of advice is that? Mr. Freeman has been hanging out with too many New Age weirdos. I was a tree in the second grade play because I made a bad sheep. I stood there with my arms outstretched like branches and my head drooping in the breeze. It gave me sore arms. I doubt trees are ever told to be the screwed up ninth grader. Gag order. David Petrakis's lawyer had a meeting with Mr. Neck and some kind of teacher lawyer. Guess who won? I bet David could skip class the rest of the year if he wanted and still get an A, which he would never do. But you better believe that whenever David raises his hand, Mr. Neck lets him talk as much as he wants. David, quiet David, is full of long, drawn-out, rambling opinions about social studies. The rest of the class is grateful. We bow down to the almighty David, who keeps the neck off our backs. Unfortunately, Mr. Neck still gives tests, and most of us fail them. Mr. Neck makes an announcement. Anyone who is flunking can write an extra credit report on a cultural influence at the turn of the century. He skipped the Industrial Revolution so he could drag our class past the year 1900. He does not want all of us in summer school. I don't want to see him in summer school either. I write about the suffragettes. Before the suffragettes came along, women were treated like dogs. Women could not vote. Women could not own property. Women were not allowed in many schools. They were dolls with no thoughts or opinions or voices of their own. Then the suffragettes marched in full of loud, in-your-face ideas. They got arrested and thrown in jail, but nothing shut them up. They fought and fought until they earned the rights they should have had all along. I write the best report ever. Anything I copy from a book, I put in quotes and footnotes. Footnote? I use books, magazine articles, and a videotape. I think about looking for an old suffragette in a nursing home, but they're probably all dead. I even hand it in on time. Mr. Neck scowls. He looks down on me and says, to get credit for the report, you have to deliver it orally. Tomorrow,
at the beginning of
class. Me? Silence. No justice, no peace. There's no way I'm reading my suffragette report in front of the class. That wasn't part of the original assignment. Mr. Neck changed it at the very last second because he wants to flunk me or hates me or something. But I've written a really good report, and I'm not going to let an idiot teacher jerk me around like this. I ask David Petrakis for advice. We come up with a plan. I get to class early when Mr. Neck is still in the lounge. I write what I need to on the board and cover the words with a suffragette protest sign. My box from the copy shop is on the floor. Mr. Neck walks in. He grumbles that I can go first. I stand suffragette tall and calm. It is a lie. My insides feel like I'm caught in a tornado. My toes curl inside my sneakers, trying to grip the floor so I won't get sucked out the window.
Sordino? Mr. Petrakis?
The suffragettes fought for their right to speak. They were attacked, arrested, and thrown in jail for daring to do what they wanted to do. Like them, Melinda is willing to stand up for what she believes, that no one should be forced to give speeches.
What is this?
Melinda has to deliver her report to the class as part of the assignment. She made copies everyone can read.
Oh, no, you don't. When I say oral, I mean oral. Now you sit down. And you read that report. Open your mouth, Sordino. Open your damn mouth. I am so sick of your attitude.
Mr. Neck has other plans. He gives me a D and escorts me to the authorities. I forgot about how the suffragettes were hauled off to jail. Duh. I go on a tour of the guidance counselor's office, principals, and wind up back in MISS. I am back to being a discipline problem again. I need a lawyer. I showed up every day this semester. Sat my butt in every class, did some homework, and didn't cheat on tests. I still get slammed in MISS. There's no way they can punish me for not speaking. It isn't fair. What do they know about me? What do they know about the inside of my head? Flashes of lightning, children crying, caught in an avalanche, pinned by worry, squirming under the weight of doubt, guilt, fear. The walls in MISS are still white. Andy Beast isn't here. Thank God for small favors. A boy with lime-colored hair who looks like he's channeling for an alien species dozes. Two goths in black velvet dresses and artfully torn pantyhose trade Mona Lisa smiles. They cut school to stand in line for killer concert tickets. MISS is a small price to pay for row 10, seats 21 and 22. I simmer. Lawyers on TV always tell their clients not to say anything. The cops say that thing. Anything you say will be used against you. Self-incrimination. I looked it up. Three-point vocab word. So why does everyone make such a big, hairy deal about me not talking? Maybe I don't want to incriminate myself. Maybe I don't like the sound of my voice. Maybe I don't have anything to say. The boy with the lime-colored hair wakes up when he falls out of his chair. The goth girls whinny. Mr. Neck picks his nose when he thinks we aren't looking. I need a lawyer. Advice from a smart mouth. David Petrakis sends me a note in social studies, typed. He thinks it's horrible that my parents didn't videotape Mr. Neck's class or stick up for me the way his folks did. It feels so good to have someone feel sorry for me. I don't mention that my parents don't know what happened. They'll figure out what happened soon enough at the next meeting with the guidance counselor. I think David should be a judge. His latest career goal is to be a quantum physics genius. I don't know what that means, but he says his father is furious. His dad is right. David was made for the law. Deadly calm, turbocharged brain, and a good eye for weakness. He stops by my locker. I tell him Mr. Knack gave me a D for the suffragette report. David, he has a point. Me, it was a great report. You read it. I wrote a bibliography, and I didn't copy from the encyclopedia. It was the best report ever. It's not my fault Mr. Knack doesn't get performance art. David pauses to offer me a stick of gum. It's a delaying tactic, the kind that juries love. David, but you got it wrong. The suffragettes were all about speaking up, screaming for their rights. You can't speak up for your right to be silent. That's letting the bad guys win. If the suffragettes did that, women wouldn't be able to vote yet. I blow a bubble in his face. He folds the gum wrappers into tiny triangles. David, don't get me wrong. I think what you did was kind of cool, and getting stuck in MISS wasn't fair. But don't expect to make a difference unless you speak up for yourself. Me, do you lecture all your friends like this? David, only the ones I like. We both chew on this for a minute. The bell rings. I keep looking in my locker for a book that I already know isn't there. David checks his watch 100 times. We hear principal bellow, "Let's move it, people." David, maybe I'll call you. Me, maybe I won't answer. Chew, chew, blow bubble, pop. Maybe I will. Is he asking me out? I don't think so, but he kind of is. I guess I'll answer if he calls. But if he touches me, I'll explode. So a date is out of the question. No touching. The beast prowls. I stay after school to work on 3 sketches. Mr. Freeman helps me for a while. He gives me a roll of brown paper and a piece of white chalk and shows me how to draw a tree in 3 sweeping lines. He doesn't care how many mistakes I make. Just 1, 2, 3. Like a waltz, he says. Over and over. I use up a mile of the paper, but he doesn't care. This may be the root of his budget problem with the school board. God crackles over the intercom and tells Mr. Freeman he's late for a faculty meeting. Mr. Freeman says the kind of words you don't usually hear from teachers. He gives me a new piece of chalk and tells me to draw roots. You can't grow a decent tree without roots. The art room is one of the places I feel safe. I hum and don't worry about looking stupid. Roots, ugh, but I try. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. I don't worry about the next day or minute. 1, 2, 3. Somebody flicks the lights off. My head snaps up. It is there. Andy Beast. Little rabbit heart leaps out of my chest and scampers across the paper, leaving bloody footprints on my roots. He turns the lights back on. I smell him. Have to find out where he gets that cologne. I think it's called fear. This is turning into one of those repeating nightmares where you keep falling but never hit the floor. Only I feel like I just smacked into the ground at 100 miles an hour. It.
Have you seen
Rochelle? You seen Rochelle? Rochelle Bruin? I sit completely still. Maybe I can blend in with the metal tables and crumbling clay pots. He walks toward me, long, slow strides. The smell chokes me. I shiver. It. She's supposed to meet me, but I can't find her anywhere. You know who she is? Me. It sits on my table. Its leg smears my chalk drawing, blurring the roots into a mossy fog. It. Hello, anyone home? Are you deaf? It stares at my face. I crush my jaws together so hard my teeth crumble to dust. I am a deer frozen in the headlights of a tractor trailer. Is he going to hurt me again? He couldn't, not in school, could he? Why can't I scream, say something, do anything? Why am I so afraid? Andy, I've been waiting outside. Rachel sweeps into the room, wearing an artsy-fartsy gypsy scarf skirt and a necklace of eye-sized mirrors. She pouts, and Andy leaps off the table. ripping my paper, scattering bits of chalk. Ivy walks through the door, bumping Rachel accidentally. She hesitates. She has to feel that something is going on. Then she takes her sculpture off the shelf and sits at the table next to me. Rachel looks at me, but she doesn't say anything. She must have gotten my note. I mailed it over a week ago. I stand up. Rachel gives us a half wave and says, "Ciao." Andy puts his arm around her waist and pulls her close to his body as they float out the door. Ivy is talking to me, but it takes a while before I can hear her. "What a jerk," she says. She pinches the clay. "I can't believe she's going out with him. Can you? It's like I don't know her anymore. And he's trouble." She slaps a hunk of clay on the table. "Believe me, that creep is trouble with a capital T." I'd love to stay and chat, but my feet won't let me. I walk home instead of taking the bus. I unlock the front door and walk straight up to my room, across the rug and into my closet without even taking off my backpack. When I close the closet door behind me, I bury my face into the clothes on the left side of the rack, clothes that haven't fit for years. I stuff my mouth with old fabric and scream until there are no sounds left under my skin.